this morning, to begin with, there's a very interesting discussion and presentation by Dr. Ravi Kapoor on living at the edge of experience, the way of the sanyasi. I request Professor Ramakrishna Rao to chair this session and to introduce the speaker.
Good morning. I think we have a very fascinating topic to begin this morning, and we have a very competent person to talk on this subject. In one of my previous incarnations, I toyed with the idea of developing a mysticism scale, a psychological measure to measure mysticism, if that could be measured. It was aborted pretty quickly because the people whom I was trying to find out if they would provide information appeared to be so different, and the only thing that was common I was able to find among all these gurus claiming to be sannyasins and attempting to teach us spirituality is their strong ego. The strong ego seems to be the only common binding feature among these many claimed mystics. But on the other hand, I see from Dr. Kapoor's trekking the hills and going to Himalayas and interviewing these people over a long period of time, I'm sure he must have gained more insights in their way of life, their belief systems, and their attitudes and reasons for renouncing the word and taking to sannyasin. In fact, sannyasin is, in the Indian tradition, is one of the more important stages in our lives. And we have, I think, in Professor Kapoor and his work, some very systematic way of understanding the phenomenon of sannyasins. And Dr. Kapoor is currently the Emeritus Professor at the National Institute of Advanced Studies here in Bangalore. He is a trained medical professional who had the highest possible training in psychiatry and had years of experience and received a number of honors. He worked in England, USA, and of course in India, and in Edinburgh. And his contributions in rural health, in community psychiatry, and many other areas are all too well known. He was also a visiting professor at Harvard on a Fulbright assignment. And he has been associated with the National Institute of Advanced Studies right from its beginning in 1988, we are told, first as full professor, then as deputy director, and later as the J.R.D. Tata visiting professor, and now as emeritus professor. Here he has been pursuing his attempt to bring together experts in different fields of knowledge. His research interests, as you can surmise, are very broad. Besides the community mental health research, cross-cultural studies and the relevance of Indian philosophical and spiritual traditions, he has also taken up for examination some important themes in the areas of social psychology. His major contributions in this field have been the study of militancy in India and psychological correlates of creativity in Indian science. His current passion is the study of the Indian sannyasins, Indian sannyasa traditions, and to understand these, he has been examining the life trajectories of the sannyasins and sadhus who live high up in Himalayas, one would hope high up in the elevations of lives, trying to understand their motivation to leave the society, the impact of their sadhana on their psychological states. He combines these research explorations with his hobby of trekking in Himalayas and with his wife, who is also a very distinguished psychologist. He spends 1 month every year backpacking in the Himalayas. His research activities have never interfered with his commitment to clinical work, and he continues to practice and write about, he calls the art of psychotherapy. I don't know whether it's science or art, but certainly it is an art, but I hope it's also some kind of a science. He has published 80 scientific papers and 4 books and has won many national and international awards. The more prominent awards that he received are the Commonwealth Fellowship, Medical Council of India Hari Om Ashram Award, and the Fulbright Fellowship of the USA. Ladies and gentlemen, I have great pleasure in presenting to you Dr. Kapoor, and I'm looking forward along with you for a very fascinating presentation. Dr. Kapoor.
Many thanks, Professor Ramakrishna. Some of you who have been working in NIAS or who have lived in Bangalore and have visited our institute have been made familiar with the course of my inquiry ever since it started about 20 years ago. But every time I make a presentation, there's some more data which I like to share, and that's what I'm going to do today. Evidenced by the title of my talk, I'm going to concentrate much more on the experiential domain today than on the objective psychological analysis of the work I'm doing. As I said, I've been doing this work, visiting the sannyasis in Himalayas for the last 20 years, and there are a number of reasons why I undertook this work. The reason as follows. Can I go to next slide, please? The first thing is that in our profession, while we have done a fair amount of work in the recognition and treatment of mental disorder, we haven't done very much in the field of mental health. Disorder we have looked into, health we have not really been able to understand as well as we would want to. It is said that the sannyasis of India, it's claimed that the sannyasis of India are able to live in this kind of a state, not only for a few moments, but can hold this kind of a state at their will. And I wanted to know, first of all, whether this is really true. What kind of psychological state these people live in. Now, paradoxically, my interest in sannyasis has also come from quite the opposite direction. Schizophrenia is a serious mental disorder about which, unfortunately, we know so little yet. One theory about schizophrenia, which has great appeal for me, is that the potential schizophrenic have very thin ego boundaries. Under stressful situations, these boundaries become even weaker, and these individuals then cannot distinguish self from non-self, thus developing symptoms like thought intrusion, delusion, hallucinations, etc. Now, there are researchers who claim that these people often develop the strategy of what may be called positive withdrawal, positively withdrawing from the society, a deliberate rejection of social contact and communication with others. And I wondered if sannyas was a technique of positive withdrawal, or at least some potential schizophrenics. Besides these two major reasons, I had some other interests. I was interested in studying mystical experience, as Dr. Ramakrishna was also at one time. Now, it's claimed that sannyasis follows specific techniques to enter mystical experience, and I wanted to get a direct description of this experience from them, and also learn more about the methods that they use to bring it about. Now, Yoga Sutras, as those who have read it know, talk of siddhis, special powers, like ability to fly, to become invisible, have strength of an elephant, and so on. It's very intriguing that 55 of the 196 aphorisms in Patanjali's Yoga Sutra are in fact devoted to the description of these cities, a very, very large chunk. It is rumored that sannyasis have the siddhic powers. And I was interested to find out whether there were really some people who would be able to go beyond the known laws of physics. One last reason for my interest in sadhus refers to my profession as a therapist. Having grown up in India, I know that many more people go to sadhus and sannyasis to deal with their emotional problems than they do to the professional psychiatrists. I wondered if there was something I could learn from sannyasis which would help me and my co-professionals become better therapists. Now, as you can appreciate, this is a very ambitious agenda, and I have been pursuing this for the last 20 years. But today, as I mentioned, I will especially relate to the experiential aspects of this work. First of all, who is a sannyasi? Let me define that. Next, please. Sannyasi is one who has given up connection with family and home, one who has taken a diksha, that's a formal initiation from a guru, one who follows specific rituals in day-to-day life as prescribed by the order to which he belongs, one who keeps celibate, and one does not indulge in any money-making enterprise and lives on alms. Now, these are the minimum characteristics of sannyasis belonging to different orders, but there are exceptions to all these. For example, there are gharwari sadhus, that is, sadhus who follow a prescribed rituals of their order, but they continue to live at home as a grihastas. There are sadhus belonging to sects like Swaminarayan sect, who own vast lands and possessions, and they don't depend on alms, they live on their own incomes. There are many mutts and ashrams which are adept at the strategies of making financial gain, but they claim that the money is for public good and not for themselves. There are also sadhus who do not take any diksha, and they say that they have taken diksha directly from God Shiva. A few words about the history of sannyas in India. It has been a part of Indian civilization almost from the very beginning. There's a claim that the pre-Aryan traditions, it is a pre-Aryan tradition. And there are those who believe that the clay figurines found in the excavation of 3,000 years old Harappan civilization, showing figures sitting with coiled hair and sitting in a yoga position, were actually those of sannyasis. This is a claim made. Now, these authorities believe that this pre-Aryan tradition was incorporated later in the Brahmanical culture to the extent that sannyas became the last of the four stages which we are all expected to go through. From a psychological point of view, I tend to think that the rigid caste structure with prescribed dharma for each of the caste groups could not but have created an antithesis for itself in the institution of sannyas. There are people who get fed up with this rigidity and would want to walk out. In any case, there is a reference to rishis and munis and sannyasis and sadhus in several of our scriptures. They're in Rigveda, in Samhitas, Brahmanas, Upanishads, and Dharmashastras. Epics like Mahabharata and Ramayana. Stories like Panchatantra, Kathasarit Sagra, Kalidasa's story, novels, and Kalidasa plays all have mention of swamis and sannyasis. A colleague of ours, Wendy Doniger, makes a very interesting analysis of the tension between asceticism and eroticism. A tension which has existed in Indian mind from the dawn of history, best epitomized in the description of Shiva, who is an ascetic par excellence and yet a householder, running off for tapas for long periods of time, only to come back to Parvati from time to time. Hindu mythology, Hindu medicine, Hindu physiology, also considers the power of semen and the power of tapas to be the same. Growing youngsters in modern Hindu households, even now, are advised by elders not to waste semen and thus retain health as well as spiritual power. Next, please. There are three major subdivisions of sannyasis. There are the Vaishnavites, there are the Shaivites, and Shaktas. Vaishnavites worship Vishnu, Shaivites worship Shiva, and the Shaktas worship the female power, the mother goddess. I'm not going to go into details of their practices, but I do want to say here that from the latest understanding, there are not less than 3,000 different subgroups of sannyasis in our country. Most of them high up in the Himalayas, but many of them living in other parts of the country also. One aspect I would like to mention is that all the three groups have their own branch of warrior sadhus called Nagas. There are the Vaishnavite Nagas, there are the Shaivite Nagas, there are Shakta Nagas. Historically, these warrior groups were created, especially by Shankaracharya, who spent a lot of time doing this creation of Naga sadhus. They were created for the protection of the other sadhus, protection from onslaughts from other sources like Islam and Buddhism even. So Buddhism also didn't want Hinduism to operate. The fact of the matter is that fear is now gone, and yet Naga sadhus exist, and they have nothing really to do except go through the strict rituals which they are supposed to go through, and then fight with each other. They are usually seen either walking naked or walking in white clothes with a swagger, smoking ganja and so on, and as I said, quarrelsome and fighting. In 1996, when I went to Haridwar, just after a Kumbh Mela was organized there, I found that one sect had thrown off the belongings of the other sect into the Ganga River, so much so that the Ganga was blocked for a week, and I couldn't get a dip. But that's just to illustrate this particular group, about whom I may not talk more afterwards. Now, my first encounters with the sannyasis, just like the encounters of Professor Ramakrishna, were not satisfactory at all. I met an internationally renowned sannyasi, I won't name him, but you can guess, who was very keen to have scientists on the board. He told me that his scientist devotees were carrying out very sophisticated experiments about the effect of specific types of meditation on the electroencephalographic patterns. When I said that the EEG patterns were in fact a very crude reflection on what was going on in the mind, he said that his EEG machine was made in Germany. Another internationally famous sannyasi asked me to feel the tightness of his gluteal muscles when I asked him if he had developed any special powers. This taught me to keep away from these jet-set swamis, and I look at those who are not seeking international fame. Now, armed with a loosely framed agenda, I have been going to the Himalayas. I start my journey from Rishikesh, which has about 300 ashrams, and Haridwar, which is about 600 ashrams. In the month of April and May, when I usually visit these places, one can see an army of sannyasis trampling on foot up and down the mountains, going or coming back from the holy centers of Gangotri, Jamunotri, Badrinath, and Kedarnath, all of which are above 10,000 feet high. One also sees throngs of devotees who come to take bath in Ganga, as well as to sit at the feet of the sannyasis, wanting to learn how to lead life less painfully. Now, I have interviewed more than 100 sannyasis in these 20 years. I have, as I said, a loosely framed agenda, which inquires about life trajectory, reasons for taking sannyas, details of the spiritual practices, the relationship with Guru, relationship with God and Godhead, the relationship with other sannyasis and society at large. How do these people handle their sexual needs, about their mental health, about mystical experiences and special powers, if any? Now, I'll pick up a few items. Each interview takes at least 2 to 4 hours, but sometimes I've stayed on with the sadhu for days to inquire more deeply into his lifestyle, if that person interests me. Now, first of all, reasons for taking sannyas. From this perspective, I divide the interviews into two groups. Firstly, there are those who become sannyasis because of some unpleasant happening in their life. Poverty, loss of a dear one, loss in financial dealings, being hurt or cheated by others. And secondly, there's the group of people who have actually wanted to be sannyasis right from as long as they can remember, from very early childhood. And it is this group which interests me much more. Because I do not have much problem understanding the psychology of the first group. If life has dealt with you harshly, and there is a space which society provides in which your basic needs are met, and you have a chance of dealing with your pain, sadhuhood can become a very attractive proposition. However, my inquiries revealed that most of this group, who come because of some happening in their life, continue to carry their baggage of pain, despair, doubt, betrayal, and disillusionment. It is the second group which baffles me. As a psychiatrist, I have a special training in digging up dirt in people's lives. Forgive me for saying that. That's my job. But in the members of this particular group, I have not been able to discover any incident or experience which could have driven them to this otherworldliness. I'll give you a few examples. There was this rich farmer's son who ran away from his home three times in his life. First at the age of 9, then the age of 16, and then the age of 22. Each time he was brought back home, put back to the school and studies, and ultimately he got a first-class degree in sociology, and then a master's in sociology. People were very happy, the family were happy that he's doing well. And then once he was going to Delhi for a job interview, when he met a sannyasi on the train, he got down with the sannyasi at the station the sannyasi was getting down to and never came back home. So this is one example of persons who have been trying hard to get away right from the beginning. There's this fascinating story of a woman who could recite mantras when she was 4, had memorized Bhagavad Gita by the time she was 7, and decided to take sannyas when she went at the age of 15 to listen to a spiritual lecture by a well-known sannyasi. The family tried hard to fight this desire of hers, persuading her first to become a doctor, then a postgraduate in obstetrics, and then a medical superintendent of the hospital. She gave in each time, but finally when she was around 40 and still unmarried, she got initiated with sannyas. She rolled with laughter as she narrated her story. Though she occasionally gets called to perform medical duties in the ashram where she lives, she spends most of the time in her sadhana and transcribing her guru's teachings. I met another very interesting Swami this year. He is a graduate from IIT Madras. He also wanted to become a sadhu right from his childhood, but planned first of all to complete his education, settle his brothers and sisters, and then become a sadhu. At the age of 42, he was a vice president of a multinational engineering company and had fulfilled his obligation to his family. And at that time, when he was the top of his, pinnacle of his glory, he resigned from his job and has been a sannyasi since then, as he had planned earlier. And he goes around villages teaching the villagers simple principles of technology and science. That's what he does. As I said, none of the above and many others have seen have any psychological sensible reason to give up early life. They were all from happy families. They were good students. They were well integrated in their social network. And if asked why they took up sannyas, all of them say it is because of prarabdha, their karma in previous lives. Now, one cannot scientifically argue with these statements. One just has to accept or not accept what they're saying. But on further inquiry from these people, I found some common features. A pleasure in aloneness. Even in childhood, I get stories. You know, I used to go away from my home in the evening into the woods and listen to the birds. Interested in music, interested in philosophy as they grow up. So these kind of patterns are there. I cannot help asking my colleagues in my profession to consider seriously another temperament besides the temperaments which have been described, the temperament of asceticism. I would like to consider ascetic personality, which has not been well described in my sciences. Now, all the sannyasis have a daily routine of sadhana or spiritual practices they perform. The practices differ according to sect they belong to. There are the Vedantins who spend their life studying scriptures with a view to changing their mental attitudes through intellectual discourse. There are others who have more emotional routines, singing bhajans to their chosen deities. There are those who follow the discipline of hatha yoga, and then there are those who take impossible vows. I've seen sannyasis standing on one leg for hours, for days and months, as claimed by those around him, but hours I've seen. And I've seen sannyasis with heavy wooden wheels around their necks as a vow. These crude methods are not really approved by other sannyasis. But I have encountered other type of vows. There are those who vow never to eat any cereal, live only on fruits. One Swami Ramdas, who actually lived up to the age of 102, lived in the same cottage at the 11,000 feet high because he had taken a vow after his guru passed away that he will never leave that particular place. Once he fell ill and needed an operation, his devotee had to fly a surgeon and his team by a helicopter, since Swami Ramdas refused to budge. There are others who take a vow to be moving all the time, since staying at one place encourages building up emotional relationships. This is what they say. So these are, I call them, wandering sadhus. The discipline of sadhana and the pride of successfully keeping vows certainly build up their confidence and their convictions. Do you not worry, I ask them, where your next meal is going to come from? I challenge God not to provide food, said one of them. I challenge God not to provide food. How dare he not? The kind of conviction you can see. Conviction in his deity, in his belief. There was this weather-beaten Naga sadhu sitting on the roadside waiting for a vehicle to take him to Badrinath, as he was too old to travel on foot. How long have you been waiting? I asked him. 3 days, he replied. One of my devotees has trucks which regularly take food stuff up to Badrinath. And I hope one of those trucks will take me. I asked him, how often do these trucks go up? He said, I don't know. Why do you not take a bus? I said. He said, I don't have money. Well, I thought it was a chance to talk to him. So I sat down with him and started conducting my interview with him. When I had finished, I gave him 100 rupees. He chuckled and said, see, God has provided. The magic is not that God provided through me, as I keep reminding people who have listened to me before. The magic is his conviction that God would take him, will take him to Badrinath somehow, sometimes. This is the conviction, experience of conviction, which I want to address. Now let us look a little deeper into the lives of some other sadhus. There's this well-known erudite Swami who's in his 80s and runs 3 ashrams across the world. He's up at 4 a.m. and sleeps at 11 p.m. daily. That's his routine. He delivers 4 lectures a day. I've been following him for the last 10 years, and this routine he has not budged from. 4 lectures a day. Once he went for a meeting to Delhi from Rishikesh, a distance of about 250 kilometers, returned the same night, and delivered a 1-hour lecture before he called it a day. I asked him, do you not get tired of people around you, milling around you? Don't you want some free psychological space for yourself? He said, no, I do not have any private space, and I do not have any private time. There are those who insist on managing him, of course, who would not let people go to him. You know, there are always people like that surrounding the Swami. But this answer seemed very interesting to me. I don't have a private space. It seemed that he had completely lost a sense of separate self and tried to at least identify totally with the mankind as a whole. Let us look at another Swami. He's not highly educated, not erudite like the person I talked about. He does not speak English and has no foreign devotees. I think this is this is important to remember. But he also spends at least 12 hours a day with people, listening to their woes, telling them instructive stories, or just laughing with them. People just come from anywhere to spend an hour, a day, or a month at his place. He never asks when they intend to leave. He's a past master at using one person's skill to help another person. The first day I met him, as soon as I arrived at his ashram, he got me busy seeing some sick people. He knew that I was a doctor. He asked other people to find jobs for the other people who don't have a job. Rich people don't provide him a job. Some find work in the ashram against payment. He pays everybody for as long as they stay. I saw him giving filial love to a boy who had recently lost his father and playfully asking a woman who had come to complain about her husband to mend her own ways first. He also seemed totally, totally available to everyone. Let me describe an incident which took place in this ashram. A man of about 40 came to the ashram one day and was sitting in a corner, appearing to be quite agitated. When I asked him what was bothering him, he said he was in fact the son of the Swami. Apparently, his father had left home when he was himself only 8 months old. And when he grew up, he saw a photo of the Swami, which resembled the photo of his father, which his mother had shown him. Since then, he was chasing this man up. He had come to claim his father. I encouraged him to go and talk to Swamiji in private. So he went up. They both came down in about an hour and a half. And Swamiji was laughing loudly, and the man was looking a bit abashed. He says, "I'm his father," Swamiji announced to everybody sitting there. "Of course I'm his father." After a dramatic pause, he said, "I'm his father just like I'm a father of all of you sitting here." Then he hugged the man and asked him to stay as long as he wanted. This was his home. He was his father. Take your time. Enjoy yourself here. Stay even all the time. I would have expected an ordinary person, if such a claim was made, to be at least embarrassed and be in a defensive attitude. Now, all of the sannyasis of this particular group exhibit high energy, cheerfulness, and sense of public service. I trekked up to meet a sadhu who lives at 15,000 feet high. When he saw me and my wife looking tired, he first heated up water to soothe our feet and then got going with cooking some dal and roti. Everything was done with good cheer and smile on his face. Swamiji asked him, "Do you not get lonely here? You're living alone, and in winter months nobody can come up the hills to meet you." And his answer was very interesting. He said, "You see, I'm a man with laddus in both hands. When people come, I eat laddus from one hand by serving them. When I'm alone, I eat laddus from the other hand, the laddus of my communion with God." Saying this, he laughed out loudly and then proudly posed for photographs in his lion cloth while we were bundled up in warm clothes against the cold. Where does this happiness, this energy, and this love for others come from? From being free in every sense. That's my assumption. Free from possessions, free from worry about food, most importantly, no sense of separate self. All this requires a prolonged sadhana. They don't develop it overnight. This is, in my opinion, the source of boundless energy and almost childlike laughter which bursts upon the visitors every time and again. "Do you have any special power?" I ask them. Some laugh it away, some make jokes. "Yeah, I can make very good rasam," one of them said. I have not, in my last 20 years, met anyone who claims to have any powers which defy the laws of physics. Very clear in my mind. Of course, I met people who have met others, and who have met others, who have met people, sadhus, who have this ability, but I have not personally met any. Now, regarding my endeavor to find potential schizophrenics among sannyasis, was one of my main interests, when I put my question to the sannyasis, I found that there was a very clear, systematic weeding out process which took out the mentally ill people from getting any diksha. Now, mental illness is recognized by the people as at least on the outside behavior. Now, these were not given diksha. So, that didn't happen to be the expectation I had of finding some potential schizophrenics. I couldn't really do that, except one. I found one person who was living in an ashram and who, to my professional eye, appeared to be schizophrenic. He was clad in dirty clothes and he was talking and laughing to himself. Apparently, he had been in the ashram for many years. He had been an army captain who went through some family crisis and became a sadhu. Initially, he used to be very active and put his education and army training to the service of people. Slowly, he withdrew himself and now he doesn't talk to anyone. If anyone tries to talk to him, he starts abusing. Everyone in the ashram treats him with great respect. But Swamiji is mentally ill, I said. He needs treatment. He said, no, he's not mentally ill. He's just lost in God. He's at much higher plane than you and I are, he said to me, very seriously. When I still persisted in my questions, he said, don't you know the case of Totapari? Totapari is the name, the guru of Ramakrishna, who used to throw shit at people when they came to see him or abuse them. So this man is in the same tradition. Mystical experience. Now, a mystical experience, according to William James, a very famous guru of psychologists, may be defined as an intuition of a person's numerical oneness with a larger consciousness. An intuition called God by one, Brahman by other, Shunyata by a third, and so on. The important thing is that this experience, which cannot be described in terms familiar to ordinary consciousness, it's called ineffable. The main meaning is that you can't really describe it. People who have gone through the experience have tried to talk about it. And the wonderful thing is, or the boring thing is, that they always come out with very similar descriptions. From whichever culture, there's almost a monotonous similarity in what they say. The description goes like this, and that same was true for my interviewees. I felt one of the whole universe. I lost sense of myself, I lost my will, I was the hand of superior power, there was no time and space, I was ecstatic, I would love to have this experience again. This summarizes what I heard from them and what has been written about also. People who have such experience have also described having visions, and these visions often seem more real to them than what they perceive in the ordinary consciousness. The fact that people across cultures give very, very similar descriptions of this mystical experience makes one believe that there may be a physiological basis to this also. I won't go into that, but a lot of people are now working on the physiological basis of mystical experience. Final word, and then I'll stop and end up with showing you some pictures. One of the questions I asked my interviewers is whether sannyasi hadn't seen God. Have you seen God, I asked. Some of them say, no, we haven't. We are still waiting for that experience. But some of them say, yes, we have seen God. And some of them say, of course, we see God every day. The conviction on their faces and the fact that they look quite normal in other ways does not allow me to treat God experience as a hallucination. So how do I place their experience in the context of my own, which does not entertain this possibility? My answer is that I try not to. In its inner nature, a belief of any kind is sort of feeling more allied to the emotions than to anything else. What characterizes a belief is the cessation of theoretical agitation through the advent of an idea, which is inwardly stable and fills the mind solidly to the exclusion of contradictory ideas. This is true also of non-sannyasis and their beliefs, including beliefs of the scientists. We all are influenced by our history and the context in which we live. In the context of these sadhus, seeing God is an experience, the truth of which is tested by other sannyasis using age-old methods approved by the tradition to which they belong. It's not that they're untested. When they say, I've seen God, other sannyasis have a method of inquiring how do they prove it. Now, those proving strategies are not our proving strategies. This is a different reality from the one we live in, and I humbly accept this difference as long as that reality is not forcibly inflicted on me. I have my own reality. The mystical delight I see on the face of a sannyasi is no different from that of a scientist who has made a discovery and has found approval from his colleagues. This is the way I want to leave it here. I will now do what I promised, quickly go through some pictures. Next, this is Haridwar, Har Ki Pauri. Many of you have probably seen it. Next. This is the Ganga Pujan in the evenings at Haridwar. Next. See the throngs of devotees in that place. This scene is there all through the year. Next. Har Ki Pari again. Next. Go on. When I start going up. I'm moving up. Next. Moving up. Next. Next. I've reached the snow line. Next. Going to this Badrinath Road. Next. Same road. Next stream. And this is the Tapavan ashram, Tapavan area, 15,000 feet height. This is the name of this particular hill is, after the name of Shiva. Next. This is where the two tributaries of Ganga meet. Next. This is beyond Badrinath near the Tibet border. Next. A river in its full flow. Next. Me with my gear as I go up. Next. Again, same chap. Next. These are some friends I meet on the road. Next. Some more friends. Next. This is near Gaumukh. This is the Gaumukh area beyond Gangotri, where the Ganga actually starts from. Next. This is Gaumukh itself. That's a glacier, Gaumukh. And unfortunately, I've seen this glacier moving back 4 kilometers in the 20 years since I've started my work, which is a very sad state indeed of how to take care of our environment. Next. This is my wife who accompanies me. Next. This is Gangotri. Next. Again, Gangotri. Next. Badrinath. Next. This is the hot pool of Badrinath. Hot water pool. Next. This is one of the ashrams where I stay. Next. This is the non-erudite Swami whom I particularly like. Next. This is his chela. He's not yet given full diksha. This guy also wakes up at morning at 4 o'clock and sleeps at 11. And the interesting thing I see is that though he can be quite rough with people who work with, he has never disobeyed his guru. Next. This is guru doing a counseling session. Next. A group counseling session. Next. He shares the vegetable cutting with his devotees and cooks also. Next. Next. Next, next, next. Quickly, let's go through, let's go through. This is the Swami at 15,000 feet height, who posed in this lion cloth while I was bundled up in layers of warm clothes. Next. Same person. Next. Same person with a visiting sadhu in the same dress. Next. Or non-dress. These are some Naga sadhus going towards Badrinath. Next. This woman, 70 years old, actually walked 70 kilometers on bare feet, to reach Gangotri. That was her walk. Next. This is an interesting Swami I met. I never saw him quiet. He was always laughing. I almost thought he was manic. But if I went through the history of this man, I found that he had done very serious practices in his life. But at this age, I said, when did you become a Swami? And he asked me, you want to ask when did I put ashes in my hair? In Punjabi, there is an expression called Sir Swa Kadupai, which also means when you have become a totally non-entity. Very fascinating man. Next. This is a Bengali Swami I met on the way to Badrinath. Next. This was a lecturer in Bhopal. Now, he became a Swami early on. And once he went to Switzerland, he was on lecture tour. And there a Swiss woman fell in love with him and said, I want to marry you. And he said, look, I'm a Swami, I can't marry. She followed him to India, insisted that if you don't want to marry him, at least give me a son. Now, apparently, as we all know from our reading of scriptures, there is a tradition of sadhus and swamis giving sons to the lay people. So he agreed. And they had intercourse. He conceived. And then he conducted the labor himself. And when the boy was born, it was a boy. After that, he has not met that woman. The boy keeps visiting him from time to time. And for the last 2-3 years, in fact, stays with him, learning from him. Next. This is the boy, half Indian, half Swiss, speaks English and French, and discusses the scriptures in very, very erudite fashion. Next. This man, he has walked more than 12,000 kilometers in the last 2.5 years, one of the wandering ones. He keeps a diary of his daily visits, daily rituals. And I've read those diaries. I saw 12 copies of 12 notebooks with him. And fascinating descriptions of where he has been. The energy of this man. Next. Same person with another sadhu. Next. This is an Agori Swami. I don't know whether you know of Agoris. The Agoris are the people who live in Shamshans, in the cremation grounds. And they're supposed to be eating human flesh. He said he did. Next. Same person. Next. This was a man who was a watchman with one company for many, many years in Bombay. Then when he was no more wanted, he was thrown out. And then he came to Joshimath. This is Joshimath picture, where he has been looking after Hanuman temple. Next. There's a woman sadhu, and she says that she prefers traveling with a male sadhu because of the safety concerns. Next. There's another sadhu. His grandfather apparently had dug himself into ground and died in that underground. That's the way he wanted to go. Now this man also wanted to do the same, and his children stopped him from doing that. So he left house and became a sadhu. I didn't really find him to be psychotic, but a very unusual person. Next. This is a Naga sadhu from Haryana, whom I interviewed. He actually became a sadhu because he was slapped by his boss. He was a cleaner with a truck. He left and became a sadhu. He still is a very touchy individual when I talk to him. Next, same person, not to give me food. I want you to see his face. Next. This was, interestingly, a person who did not want to become a sadhu. He was a kitchen hand, and he got his hand burned. And after that, he couldn't do the kitchen work, and he was thrown out by the people. He's been moving around. He has got contractures in the hands, and he says, this place gives me security and food, being a sadhu. And once my hand becomes all right, I want to do work. In fact, I gave him an address of an orthopedic surgeon who specialized in hand surgery, and I hope he has gone and seen him. Next. 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 This is the guy who actually went with me first time when I went to Gangotri. Interestingly, I kept his picture here because he told me a story of a girl who had actually, is it done? Okay. Who had fallen down on the ravines below. And he said, you know, what a lucky girl. And I thought, what about her parents? What do they think? Next. Go on. Just go on. If there's an interesting one, I'll speak and let it be. Go on, go on, go on, go on, go on. Next. Keep going. This is the next. Go on. Keep going. Keep going. Keep going. This is the sadhu who wanted to go to Badrinath, and I gave him 100 rupees. Next. A Vedantin. Next. A man who distributes free food every year to people. Next. A Garbari sadhu. Next. Next. Please keep going. I don't know. This is the one who is a schizophrenic in my language, and my colleagues will recognize it, but who lives in the ashram and respected by everybody. I think I'll stop here. Yeah, and thank you all for giving me time. Oh, I wish you had mentioned it earlier, I would have stopped earlier.
Does it form a sort of community by itself?
Yes.
That wouldn't...
Hang on.
Yeah.
Community in the sense that some live in ashrams, and that's a community setting. But some are independent, live alone. So there are various kinds of degree to which they interact with others. Interaction with the earning grastas of the society, that's not the interaction which they normally keep. Within themselves, they do, many of them work together.
So how would you compare this experience with the experience of people who join cults? Would you say it's diametrically opposite? Because people who join cults very often need a sense of identity, mm-hmm. I think. And that's why they join a cult, because they can belong to a particular
group. I won't go into detailed answer to this question, but you have read about the cults and the damage they are able to perform, give to the people who belong to the cult. This doesn't happen in this particular group. Thank you, Doctor. The point is that since this was not a statistically based study, my percentages will not mean much. That depended on whom I met. But about 40% of those I studied had run away. 60% had not. But don't take this for any kind of a description of actual numbers.
Do you see any difference between this?
I've mentioned to you. The description is these people seem to carry this baggage along with it, the baggage of pain and disillusionment. And the like the Nagasadhu, I assured you, very touchy man. And others don't.
I have a question. I'm just wondering, how did you pick which sadhu to talk to? I mean, did you just meet them as you saw them, or did you have some plan?
See, in a semi-anthropological study like this, you don't pick people. It's not easy to find people who want to talk to you. So I didn't pick. But intuitively, I suppose I moved from people who would not give me any solid information to those who are willing to give me information. Thank you, sir.
Dr. Kapoor, and thank you, Professor Ramakrishna Rao. Thank you for such an exciting presentation. We break for tea, but before that, I would like you to acknowledge the presence of a very learned and noted Indologist and dancer of this country, Dr. Mrs. Mrinalini Sarabhai. Let us give her a standing applause. We break for tea now. I hope everybody is back here. Just one announcement, whosoever is leaving this evening, whosoever's flight is this evening, please contact Mariamal, who is outside, so that she can tie up your taxis and any other thing you would like to. So please contact Mariamal about if you are leaving this evening. Dr. Kapoor has a bad backache, so he won't be able to chair this session. I've requested Professor Ramakrishna Rao to chair this session, and he has agreed to do that. Dr. Narayanan Srinivasan and myself will be speaking. So let me request Professor Ramakrishna Rao to start this session.
Narayanan Srinivasan from the Center for Behavioral and Cognitive Sciences, University of Allahabad. And Professor Narayana Srinivasan is mainly interested in studying visual perception and attention, consciousness, and computational modeling of cognitive processes. He did his master's degree in electrical engineering from Indian Institute of Science right here, and the master's project was on EEG signaling process. During his doctoral work at the University of Georgia with Dr. James Brown, he has looked into the interaction between attention and spatial frequency processing. He did his postdoctoral work at the University of Louisville with Edward S. Koch on diagnostic algorithms of glaucoma. He is currently working at the Center for Behavioral and Cognitive Sciences at the University of Allahabad with Dr. Janak Pandey, an old friend of ours. And this is one of its kind, supported by the University Grants Commission. We are all looking forward to many good things to happen from him and his colleagues and students. And Dr. Narayan will now present to us. Where is he? Is he? Oh, yes, please.
First, I would like to thank Sangeetha for inviting me, and it's a pleasure to be here at NIAS, especially near the place where I study. I'm going to be talking about meditation, brain, and cognition. I know a lot of you have an interest in meditation, so I hope you'll find here something that is useful. I'll focus on certain types of studies on meditation, not everything on meditation, and let's see. Okay, what I'm going to do is first to set up the approach that we use to study meditation. A lot of people approach it in different ways. I'm basically a cognitive scientist, so let me just basically say what cognitive science does. As it says, basically we respect the phenomenology of meditative experience. Okay, so we don't trust it completely. And studies meditation within the constraints of empirical research. It's very important, it's a factor to be remembered. And when you start studying meditation, there are actually two types of changes one can look at. And it is important, and actually it is very difficult to distinguish between the two. These are both what are called state changes and trait changes. State changes are changes that are occurring temporarily when somebody is actually meditating, they experience something different. Okay? Now, trait changes are changes that occur over a long period of time, probably may change a person, either in their experience or in their external behavior. It could be both. Maybe the trait changes that have occurred over a period of time can have an effect on a particular state change when they are actually meditating. Okay, so there is something that occurs over a period of time even in their experience as well. And of course, the whole discipline is such that it draws heavily from mainly psychology and neuroscience and a little bit of philosophy thrown in. Most of you are familiar with this, but I just thought I'd put up the slide, and Professor Kapur also mentioned some of these things. There are various characteristics of meditative experience. A lot of people, when you ask them, they say, so there is loss of awareness of surroundings, feelings of timelessness, transiency, especially it doesn't last for hours, it lasts for, you know, maybe minutes, maybe to half an hour, sense of ineffability. There is like cosmic union consciousness, transcendence of space and time. So these are some of these features that people normally report when you ask them, what did you experience? Okay. And what we are trying to do is actually find, in one sense, sort of neural correlates of these experiences. That's the ultimate aim, to find some sort of neural correlates of these experiences and then try to understand what's happening. When you start looking at meditation, the first thing which actually makes a difference sometimes is the purpose. So different people meditate for different reasons. So when they go into meditation, a lot of these days people meditate because they just want to avoid stress, they want to relax, or they want to feel one with the world. There could be any number of reasons to actually get into, and because meditation actually differs from other altered states of consciousness in the sense the voluntary nature of it. It's not like taking drugs. Once you take the drug, it just runs its sort of course. But meditation is different because you have to put in a lot of effort. And so the sort of meditative experience people may have will also depend on their motivation for starting the whole thing in the first place. And when you start looking at methods, meditation is, once again, there is no one technique. There are innumerable number of techniques and differences between how people meditate. So it's simple things like postures. So most people, the standard way of looking at it is they, you know, sit in a lotus position and then meditate, but that's not what everybody does. So there are people who stand and walk and meditate. There are people who do all sorts of things, who relax in a chair and then meditate. And people look at mirrors and meditate. People put something on a tape and then meditate. There are various things. So different people meditate in different ways. And the sort of changes that it may have on meditative experience is something that we need to be aware of. They may be different. And when you look at types of meditation, well, there are lots of names, but the simplest way to categorize it into two different techniques is either mindfulness meditation, in which case your sort of attention is spread out, you don't try to control your thoughts in general, and then be receptive to everything that is occurring. Okay, that's the sort of vague definition. Then there is concentrative meditation, where you actually focus your attention on something specific to start with. It could be a mantra, it could be your breathing, it could be anything. But the point here is you are concentrating on a particular aspect and then you go with it. So the whole idea when you start studying meditation is to start thinking, okay, there may be differences, but maybe they all share some common mechanisms. So, and we hope to see what they are. And when you start looking at them, one of the common features is, and the way, cognitive way of looking at it, is that the sensory input is gradually diminished. Whatever external input that is coming from the world reduces over a period of time, okay, irrespective of the type of meditation. And typically, as I said, it entails concentration in some form or another. And the whole point here is, it is this attentional effort. So the effect of attention on meditation is very important. This voluntary attentional process is the one that drives it and eventually, in some sense, removes all the content, if you want to speak, from the experience. Okay. This is a one slide primer on the brain. Most of you probably have seen it. For our point, forget about it. This part is the prefrontal cortex, which is at the front. This is the occipital cortex, which is at the back. This is parietal. Excuse me. Okay. And then there is the temporal cortex and the occipital. I mean, this is just broad division into four lobes. That's it, nothing much. If you look at here, this is another way of looking at it, which is a sort of slightly hierarchical way of looking at how the brain is organized, and sometimes it is helpful. You start from here, this is the brainstem, which mainly is important for arousal. Then you get to the thalamus, which actually, you know, acts as some sort of a communication channel, if you want to think about, does a lot of work. Then you have the limbic system, which Sumantra Chatterjee talked about yesterday. So you have the hippocampus, and you have the cingulate cortex and amygdala. As he mentioned, the amygdala does the emotional processing, and hippocampus is very important in transferring, consolidating memories from short-term to long-term memory. And then on top of it, if you want to think in terms of hierarchies, it's the prefrontal cortex. Here, of course, top simply means it corresponds to where all the processing occurs in our terminology. So basically, this is perception, action, memory, and all that. So the parietal, temporal, and occipital cortexes are where the general processing of external events occur. Okay? And in this sort of framework, and of course, if you come to the prefrontal cortex, it's sort of split into two major things. One area is responsible for more like emotions, and this major area is responsible for controlling all other activities. In one sense, executive functions. That's the way people normally think about it. This is a very crude hierarchy that helps us to organize in terms of what's happening. Okay. As I said, I'm going to focus on only a small number of studies on meditation, and I will focus mostly on EEG studies because that's one of the things I do, and then some other things. So if those of you who do not know, in EEG, what we do is put a set of electrodes on the skull and then record electrical activity from the scalp. Okay. This in contrast with those who do single cell recordings, where they actually take an electrode, put it in a cell and then record. So this one is sort of a very gross, you know, monitoring of what's happening in the brain. So it records from lots of areas, so localization is not very good, but it has some other advantages. When you start doing EEG recordings, there are two major types. One is just putting there and recording EEG. The other is you give a cognitive task to a subject, a participant, and then you elicit a specific waveform which corresponds to whatever the task that they are doing. And that normally goes by the name of event-related potentials. So we do some of those and you will see some results. And typical amplitudes in each are very small, as you can see here, 50 to 200 microvolts. And it's used, it's been in use for more than 75 years, initially as a sort of tool, diagnostic tool in neurology and all that, and of course these days for as a research tool in cognitive neuroscience. Okay, what do we do with the EEG signal? Most of you may be aware of it, but basically we do what we call spectral analysis. We do Fourier transform analysis, see what sort of frequencies are there in the signal, and roughly divide into four here, and actually there is some more. But there is something called alpha, which basically is frequencies between 8 and 13 hertz. And normally you get when eyes are closed, you relax. I mean, this is for all of us. When we relax, the alpha power increases. Okay. Beta is basically corresponds to the, all the processing we do. The higher frequencies, you can see here, somewhere here, the beta is more high frequency. The alpha is, you can see, lower frequency. And of course, as you can see, one thing you notice is the frequency is coming down. The changes are more gradual. Okay, so this is typically, you know, corresponds to increased alertness and focused attention. And when you are processing something, the beta goes up, basically. And then you have theta frequencies and then delta frequencies. And delta are more common when you are asleep, for example. Okay, and there is a relationship between sleep and meditation. Okay. So, as I said, large number of studies have been done on meditation. I'm not going to review all of them, but just focus on some salient aspects. One of the things people have done, even in earlier studies, is to look at how changes are occurring over a period of time, and I'll come back to that. So, initially, in the first 50 seconds, alpha waves are increasing. After 5 to 10 minutes, there is increased amplitude of alpha. Then after some time, alpha decreases, and then theta wave started appearing, okay? And that is at a much later stage. Theta is lower, even lower frequency than alpha. Okay, and one of the things they found is, for example, in Zen meditation, the number of years spent in Zen was correlated with practice. So which means the amount of practice one has comes out to changes in EEG, okay? As I said, people have argued, I mean, this is, I put a very early study there, although there are later studies showing it, there are critical changes in EEG activity, and the claim is that may be related or at least correlated with the clarity of experience or the sort of experience that meditators have. For example, people have found that there is increase in alpha power, which, by the way, is related to decreased blood flow. So you can think of it as the overall brain activity actually coming down, okay? Among meditators. So the other thing is, when you start looking at different types of meditation, the increase in alpha power or whatever is different for different types of meditation. So there are differences even when you record the EEG for different types of meditation. So you don't get exactly the same effect, which makes it a problem anyway. And there is increased theta power. That's not the only thing we do as well. There are other sorts of analysis people have done over the years, although spectral analysis is still the most common. For example, people measure what is called coherence. It's just basically the correlation of activity occurring over different areas in the brain or in any signals. And people find when people are meditating, especially in the alpha and theta range, the coherence actually increases, especially in the frontal, sometimes in the posterior also. So the basic finding is that there is some sort of increased coherence over different areas. The second point is, this is very closely related to sleep. In sleep also, initially alpha power goes up. Okay, but the point here is there are differences between sleep and meditation as well. One point of view is you can think of it as meditation as some sort of suspended between wakefulness and sleep. It's sort of somewhere in between. Okay, and
actually, I think in sleep the blood flow to the brain increases. Actually, that's what one subjectively feels as you're falling asleep.
No. Maybe initially, but later it does decrease. Depends on the what stage of sleep you are in. So I'm not going into it. Basically, there are four stages of sleep and there are intermediate things, all that. So depends on the stage of sleep. There is also various asymmetries people have found. I'm not going to the details, but during meditation, the activity changes you see in, say, in alpha, for example, It's not across all the areas. Okay, this is not a throughout happening in the brain. That is related to only certain specific areas. Maybe in the frontal area, the alpha power increases more. Okay, remember that. If you remember the hierarchy, you will link it to it. So this increase in alpha power we are talking about, it not necessarily across the whole brain, but it's related to certain specific areas. And recently people have started looking into even higher frequencies. Okay. So for example, gamma, and they have even, I saw a study done last year looking at frequencies around 100 hertz, which is, there is no name for it specifically right now. So basically there is increase in gamma as well. And if you know the literature about 40 hertz oscillations, one of the proposals has been, which was mentioned yesterday, it's related to the binding problem. So people have proposed 40 hertz oscillations, the brain play a role in binding. The other sort of studies, EEG studies we do, is what I said is event-related potential. That is, you give a task to a particular subject and then you see what is the result of that. You take these over lots of trials, average the data, and you get a specific waveform for each task. And there is a certain pattern of shape or whatever that you get depending on the task. Okay, people have done auditory ERPs, which means give an auditory stimuli, and this is with meditators. Of course, with normal people, all sorts of studies have done. With meditators, both auditory ERPs and visual ERPs have been done, and we'll look at a couple of them. The two we are going to focus on, and we have done in our lab as well, is one is called mismatch negativity. So mismatch negativity is something that you get when you have, for example, I have a task, a lot of, say, 100 trials, in each out of 80 trials, I will just present a tone, say, 1,000 hertz. 20% of the trials, I will maybe show a tone that is 1,050 hertz. That's all it is. The subject doesn't have to do anything. What happens is, obviously, automatically, the system, if you want to think of it, recognizes that there is something that is not frequent or infrequent. So if you look at the waveform for the more frequent stimulus and the infrequent stimulus, difference, take the difference between the two waveforms, you get a specific peak, roughly around between 100 and 250 milliseconds. It's usually a negative peak. That's actually, it's called mismatch negativity. Okay, it's very specific. You don't have to do anything. You don't have to respond to the stimulus. It automatically is there. So the idea, general idea is, if you have a higher amplitude, then means basically you can detect this change. So if I vary the thing gradually, so if you have 1,000 and 1,050, you get a higher peak. If it's 1,000 and say 1,001 or 1,005, you get a lower peak or you may not get a peak. Okay. Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. So let me quickly go through the basic, some of the results. This is our preliminary, so don't come to any conclusions. Basically, what we are trying to do is, there are various, most of the studies show differences between meditators and control groups, number one. But they just don't track, say, alpha power closely over a period of time. If we are interested in how these things are changing with experience, we need to track it over a period of time. So what we are trying to do is, see how things are changing. So if it's alpha power, see how it's changing over time and try to correlate it with some sort of meditative experience. So you may ask, how do you know what the person is experiencing? The only way to ask the meditator. So what we do is, in one condition, the meditator has to meditate. I know this is not great methodology, but there is no choice. Ask the meditator to press a key when a particular state is changing. Okay. Now obviously this immediately is a confound, because they are monitoring, they know, okay, I need to press a key. This probably affects their meditation anyway, to some extent. How much, we do not know. So what we are doing is, we are recording them over 2 days. One day they have to press a key, another day they don't have to press a key. And I'm hoping we can compare the two and find something common. Okay, that's the strategy. As you can see here, this is a very grossly done thing, so actually this is wrong, this is not millisecond. These are done for various blocks, and as you can see, the powers, depending on whatever range it is, so I will just pick one arbitrarily, this is theta, it is not constant across time. Okay, this is changing, it went up, somewhat came down in between, and then sort of picks up and eventually comes down. Okay, you see the beta, which is related to processing, right? the beta. You see, it doesn't change that much. It was fairly flat and maybe increases slightly towards the end. Okay, maybe they are coming out of the meditation. So beta that is related to processing is not actually changing that much, but the other ones that are more related, they are fluctuating. Okay. The other thing is that there are different types of meditation. There are two names given here. In the mantra meditation, as you can see, once again, this is just, we just picked some portion in the middle, some portion in the beginning, and some portion at the end. So it's not really tracking over time, but we have not finished the analysis. As you can see, power is actually increasing in the middle for this type of meditation. So it starts off, shoots up, comes back down. Okay. So there are some pretty pictures here, but just I'll just point out to one thing. This is referred to the theta band, and this is refers to delta. As you can see, there are changes. For example, here theta is very less in the frontal region. It actually shoots up here in between, and towards the end it just sort of goes down. Okay, it's sort of reflected in the graph shown before, but this shows there are 64 electrodes in our cap. So basically we have data from 64 electrodes, and there is no way you can plot it and then see it. So this is the one convenient way of looking at it. Okay. We also find differences in amplitudes of the mismatched negativity task. So once again, even that result depends on what type of meditation. This one is those who do Sudarshan Kriya, Sahasamadhi meditation and all that. You can see here, initially this is the blue line, that amplitude is here, the waveform, this is what we are referring to. Then the pink one here, the amplitude increases, but after they do what they call Sahaj Samadhi meditation, the amplitude is increased, and this is for only one electrode data, this is where it's usually prominent, and the amplitude is increased and the latency has decreased. If you look at mantra meditation, those who chant some mantra and then concentrate and meditate, you can see here, initially the amplitude is similar to some of these people, but it's actually almost gone. So different types of meditation show end up having different effects. There are imaging studies recently using fMRI, PET and all that. Once again, they show certain activations in various brain regions, typically in the prefrontal cortex. There is some increased activation which is related to the fact people are doing it voluntarily. So voluntary attention is being used. Okay, there are lots of hypotheses, and this is one, comes from a friend of mine, I have put it. One issue is, argument is, the frontal part, cortical activity actually has to go down. And going down, that going down is very important for having these experiences. So what typically happens is, as I said, the alpha power and the theta power goes up in the frontal cortex. But if you use fMRI, those areas that are specific for attention actually show increased activation in the beginning. Okay? So that's related to that. So the idea is, when you use your attention, all of you, I hope you know, your working memory capacity is very limited. So when you start chanting a mantra, it basically occupies your working memory completely. Which means if your working memory is completely occupied, you cannot process any stimulus. Okay? Because the capacity is limited, if you're going to fill it up with only the mantra, or whatever, breathing or whatever, then there is no capacity to do any external, any other processing. That's the way the explanation will go. And basically, that's the result of it. So people have done not only that, look at behavioral studies. And since I study perception, I'm interested in that. So there is one phenomenon called binocular rivalry, where you present two different stimuli to the two eyes. Normally what will happen is that they will actually alternate in time. You don't see a mixed up version of the two. You see the left eye one for some time, then the stimulus present to the right eye for some time, and this will alternate. This is called binocular rivalry. And meditators show differences, and depending on the type of meditation. There is another thing called motion-induced blindness. Let me try a demo. I don't know how much. That depends on the type of meditation. So the finding is, they tried with Tibetan meditators. They found large increases with what they call one-point meditation, which is in the Tibetan tradition, but with this so-called compassion meditation, that's another term they use, they did not find any effect. Okay, that's the specific. Let me just show this demo and end my talk. Okay, what you have to do is, you'll see three dots, And you have to fix it at the center, so if you want to... Okay, let me see whether it works or not. Okay, I'm going to play this. Focus here, all of you, okay? And then you tell me what happens. Just focus here somewhere. I know it will be very difficult for people here as well. And this is also the monitor's too big. But anyway. Yeah, well, it varies. You cannot predict it. The dots start disappearing, okay? It is basically what is called motion-induced blindness. It is the motion that induces the blindness, okay? What happens is that dots disappear and there is no predictive nature to it and there is no clear-cut explanation for this phenomenon. So you can be blind even when the stimulus is there, okay? This is another version of it. Okay, I'm done. So what interesting thing is, this disappearing duration, people have found that with meditators, it actually increases. There is actually, even the ones that disappear actually come back. If you keep, it's sort of this come back, something thus goes, and that comes back. But for them, it just disappears for a longer period of time. Okay, for meditators. And apparently with one meditator, a dot disappeared for 723 seconds, which is a very long time. So, and people have also found even in simple things like contrast sensitivity functions that your basic visual acuity actually goes up when you meditate. Now, I'm not too sure, but there are some suggestions that it actually goes up. And things like, well, critical flicker fusion frequency. Don't worry about the term. It just basically means that we are sensitive to things that are flickering, but if the rate is very high, we don't see it. That's the technique that's used in movies, in your computer monitors. This is already flickering at probably 65 hertz. Normal cutoff for our sensitivity is around 45 hertz. Anything above 45 hertz, we don't see it as flickering. We see it as not moving. So there are differences there as well. Okay? So let me conclude it by saying that, that studies based on cognitive and neuroscientific approaches have contributed to the understanding of meditative experience. We are learning slowly some things. EEG studies, imaging studies show definitely changes in neural processes correlated with meditative experience. The problems exist, especially with different types of meditation, different methodologies we use, and putting it all together, we don't have still have a clear-cut idea of all the fundamental mechanisms that work, but we are working on it. And the hope is that comparative study of meditation, different types of meditation will really be useful in getting the similarities as well as differences. Thank you. And of course, I will end with, since a lot of literary people are here, you can read this. That's from Emily Dickinson.
Thank you very much for a very interesting talk. This research has been going on for over 45 years, nearly 50 years. Trying to understand the physiological correlates of meditative experience, practice of meditation. I have a very fundamental question for the whole approach that you have taken and the conclusions that you have drawn. Since the time of the early work of Kasamatsu and Hirai, who worked on Zen meditators, compared to the work of Anand and his colleagues at the All India Institute of Medical Sciences in Delhi on people practicing the Indian type of concentrated meditation. We recall that the results are very different in both cases. In one case, there is an evidence of habituation. In another case, there is no evidence of habituation. But the point of difference was explained in terms of the meditative practice. In Zen, for example, it was found that any time a stimulus was applied, the individual is actually responding to that. And there was no habituation. But in the case of the Indian meditators, it was found that they were blocking. They were not responding at all to the external stimulus because their meditative practice is a different kind. And therefore, we have had examples of this sort all through the research in the area of meditation and physiology, that distinctions seem to appear, discrepancies exist between different types of practices of meditation and the physiological correlates. All that we seem to know through this research during 40, 50 years is that perhaps there is some kind of an hemispheric coherence in these EEG studies. Apart from that, I do not really see very much that binds all these different kinds of practice of meditation. Therefore, my question to Dr. Narayanan is, from his review of the literature, from his perspective, does he really see, in addition to the possibility that practice of meditation can give us a control over our internal states, can we have a physiologically unique state of the brain that is relevant to meditation? In fact, the claim has been made by Wallace using transcendental meditation that he did find a unique physiological state, but that is about it. I don't think anyone today believes that Wallace's findings can be generalized. And therefore, as you embark on this very important adventure, I mean, what he is doing is tremendously important. In our country, one of the few centers where this kind of work is going on. Do you really believe that you can find a unique physiological state associated with these meditative practices?
The answer is, I don't think so. It will not be a unique physiological state because we are not looking at a particular state. A state is something that is specific, defined at only a particular time. What you are looking at different mechanisms that are operating, and that will be a different sort of thing. So for example, the loosening of control of the frontal areas over other areas, weakening, that will be a stable result that probably happens in meditation. Whether it, the only difference is, important difference is, in meditation it occurs voluntarily. In some of the other altered states of consciousness, it occurs in sleep. But again, once you initiate the sleep, after that it just, the process goes on automatically. So that will probably a feature that will be definitely be stable irrespective of the type of meditation. Because if you are all the time monitoring your own thoughts and trying to control your thoughts, you will be unable to meditate. So that needs to go. So that will be one possible mechanism, and that is what I have put up there, I think will be there, definitely. And there will be multiple mechanisms. I don't think there is just one mechanism that will just explain the whole thing, because there will be like 10, 15 mechanisms probably interacting with each other, and then that will produce a certain effect.
This is just a question that during the alpha state, we are in a sort of a relaxed state. But the people who do regression, they induce the alpha state to activate the memory retrieval process. Does alpha state also stimulate the memory retrieval process? Because the memory of past life or, childhood becomes too active when in certain, I'm talking from personal experience.
I have absolutely no idea. Okay. The evidence for such things are not so clear that I would say that it is related to memory recall, because we hardly understand the mechanisms of memory recall, and I don't think it will be related, just related to alpha power or something. As I said, this is just a simple way of EEG still, cannot answer those questions. There are those who do molecular studies. There are those who do behavioral studies. There are who even are trying to come up with modeling work. And all these need to be put together. So until then, I mean, as for the memory question, I don't think so. My personal thing is I don't think there is any relationship. My guess. They show different frequencies. It's not specific to meditation. Obviously, the babies show lower frequencies. So for example, theta, which you normally see increasing in meditators, interestingly, the percentage is fairly high. Theta power is fairly high in babies. But theta power is also high in some other animals like rats.
So if you want to come to some conclusions, I don't know. It's up to you.
I have a question here.
Yes.
Besides the studies you have quoted, the recent work of Newberg and his colleagues,
yes,
on the parietal lobe.
I know, yes.
That was left out. But it's interesting that different studies have shown different areas showing hypofunctioning. He talked of right parietal lobe.
His claim is that when the frontal activity goes up, correspondingly the activity in parietal lobe is decreasing. The implication there, I know I just went over that slide, but there is a strong evidence that the sense of self is linked to activities in some areas in the parietal lobe. So those with parietal lobe lesions, for example, or some patients exhibit that they just don't realize that the self, that it is me, other, that the distinction very well.
The question I really want to ask is that in all these different techniques, though you see different physiological responses, one thing which is commonly described is the pleasurable experience, the experience of pleasure. Now, how does those linkages occur between all these techniques and the emotional areas, and how do they come up?
Well, as I said, emotion, of course, amygdala is where everybody focuses on, but there is any area in the frontal cortex itself, which is the ventromedial prefrontal cortex, where emotional processing occurs, and what we normally think of controlling as emotion, controlling our emotions. Mm-hmm. And these two frontal areas are linked heavily. Both the part you want to think of it as your cognitive frontal area and your emotional frontal area.
I'm really asking about the hypothalamic connections. Are there studies done on what happens in the hypothalamus when these experiences are gone through?
The general finding, and this doesn't come from EEG.
No, of course not.
Yeah.
But
there are indications that the subcortical activity actually goes up. For example, more neurotransmitters are released in the subcortical area. So the thalamus activity goes up. I don't know about the hypothalamus. My guess is the general indication is subcortical activity goes up. The cortical activity comes down, what we normally think of.
Could we do evoke potential studies in this area?
No.
Is it possible?
The evoke potential studies will not pick up subcortical areas. I mean, this technique will not
work. There should be something to done to link that up. That's what my worry, concern is. Thank you.
Love to. Right now it's running, ongoing.
No, so the graph that you have shown.
Oh, I said that's from an individual meditator. That's why I said don't come to any conclusions. What we have so far are four from who have done Sudarshan Kriya. If my memory is right, I have asked me Sunashruti. Yes, individual variation is high, but for example, we recorded from a meditator who did two types of meditation for us. So he actually did four sessions. Very patiently. So he did mantra meditation and he did what is called self-inquiry. So from the same subject, we have two types of meditation. So that provides a sort of control, so to speak, over, you know, using different subjects. But there is no alternative. I mean, that is something we have to manage. No solution. Yes, I told you. There are differences. When you say increase in alpha power, it's compared to the normals only. So this is compared to normals, yeah. And over also time also. So as I said, the real problem is parceling those two out is very difficult. So compared to controls, they show higher alpha power. For example, even when you do the MMN, if you compare with the controls, there are differences. But when they are meditating also, there are differences. So whether these differences are something that is occurring transiently over a period of minutes or because they have been practicing for 20 years, that is difficult to parcel out, and that's one of the difficulties.
Here it seems to have a pressing question. Okay, last one. Yes.
More pleasurable experience than people who were doing some formless meditation also. How do you differentiate that? Or do you, have you done any studies or study has been done somewhere else regarding meditation that is, the experience or EEG of the brain during this mass bhajans or where they get a ecstatic state?
Well, I cannot do EEG when somebody is doing bhajans.
They reach a kind of meditative state as they do.
Yeah. Well, the general claim we are trying to propose in these sorts of things is that when people do bhajans and get into ecstatic states, like most of the outer states, the frontal activity probably goes down, but the temporal lobe activity probably goes up. Okay, this is the general link that, for example, people like Ramachandran have proposed with related to temporal lobe epilepsy patients and all that. But nobody actually put anything on somebody who's doing this and found anything. I mean, you cannot do it, so I don't know. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Namaste to all of you. After Professor Mahadevan's presentation on the conscious bacteria, a few of them crept into my throat, and I have a serious throat ache. And because of this very bad throat, my brain is not functioning so well. And that's why I faded the brain, and I thought what I could do best is just to be. So I request your patience for whatever I'm going to say in a few 20 minutes. I would like to raise a few larger questions on the major theme of this conference itself. Let's begin with a story. just stay there. This is a story from the Kathava Upanishad. Many of you would have heard. This young boy, Najiketa, going to the god of death, Yama. And when he reaches there, he finds that Yama is not there. He has gone into a serious mission. So he waits there for 3 days. And anyway, to cut the story short, when Yama returns back, he's so impressed by this young boy having waited so much with so much patience for 3 days. And he's so overwhelmed by Najiketa, he asks, okay, now go ahead, ask me 3 boons. And there are a lot of other things also in the story where Emma tries to, pamper him and kind of attract him to so many nice things which you can have in life. But finally, Najiketa ends up asking the 3 boons. And the first is, he says, let my family be in peace. His first boon is relating to the family. And the second boon, he asks, okay, teach me Agni Vidya. Agni Vidya is a Vedic ritual for the community. And finally, he asks, what is that which exists after death? What is immortality? And that was the third question Najiketa asked Yama. And of course, Yama would have fallen in real trouble with these three very important issues. So the third boon relates to the individual. So if you look at these 3 boons as narrated in the story, and in general, our way of looking at things and experiencing in Indian wisdom traditions, you see that we have concerns for individual good, social good, and the need to relate to a spiritual dimension. And that's the reason that in India, religion and spiritual pursuit is a discipline for expanding consciousness from the confines of your ego, individual ego, to the dimensions of the cosmic. And this is what Tantra, Vedanta, Yoga, and other traditions represent in their practice and philosophy. Experience, self, and well-being, these are the 3 guidelines for the practice of so-called science in India, be it Ayurveda, cosmology, mathematics, and so on. Now, consciousness studies involve experience and first-person approaches, if you look at the various traditions in Indian philosophy. And also, I should say mainly, reorganizing the self through the practice of certain values and certain ways of living. The Indian ideas in general and the Hindu ideas, beliefs and practices may greatly contribute to a dialogue between science and alternate traditions, primarily spiritual experience traditions, to define and modify or deepen our ways of understanding consciousness, agency and well-being. Now, if you look at the history of consciousness studies, we see two dominant trends. The first trend could be described as the dualistic approach, of course, inaugurated by Descartes and then taken up by David Chalmers in a very strong manner, where explanation becomes the focus, and also where explanation and theories are object-oriented. And this is one reason that this gives rise to periodic explanatory puzzles and the binding problem. The explanation of one, which is the brain, is also the explanation of the other, such as the behavior and mind. And how discrete quantitative neural processes give rise to subjective, unitary, and qualitative experience, which you call as the conscious experience. The second class, you could put syncretic approaches, where you could classify many Eastern traditions, where experience is the focus, theories are rather person-oriented and less object-oriented. Theories have a facility to adopt new concepts and method to explain something complex, and there are more of experiential intimacies and less of explanatory puzzles in these trends. Now, if you look at, again, some of the questions concerning consciousness in the context of a multidisciplinary innovation in this field, there is, in the first instance, you have the classical questions and pedantic approaches because of a single discipline centeredness, and it's all started like that. But then, different phases of consciousness are being focused by different disciplines today. The multidisciplinary challenges, questions, method, as well as the understanding of something complex like consciousness. And this could be in terms of emergence of new concepts and consensus for concepts and issues having singular importance for ideas such as the self. And because of multidisciplinarity, there are also two other interesting phenomena that have happened. One is the definition of consciousness itself keep changing, ranging from functional and neural to subjective, aesthetic, and experiential. And because of multidisciplinarity, the focus for our analysis and understanding has shifted from mind-body dualism to a consciousness-brain experience syncretism. So there's already a shift from a so-called dualism to something a little more deeper. The former focus had scope for limited dialogue, but the latter, consciousness-brain experience, results in rich dialogues between what was purely considered as scientific phenomenon and so-called spiritual experiences. Now, what are the basic but exciting questions if you look at consciousness? The first question is, like anything, you ask, what is consciousness? I'm sure that every one of us here in this conference hall has that question. We have it in the title of the theme of the conference, and many of us are talking about it. What exactly it is? What is consciousness? Can we give a working definition? Can you give an operational definition? So it is something like when you are completely unaware of somebody, at least you need a name for it. So how can you define consciousness? What are the basic parameters to define consciousness? I mean, there are definitely very different kind of definitions, which we will not go into, but based on neural data, experiential data, just sensory perceptions are some of these definitions, which are, of course, in the mainstream. Now, the second question is, where is consciousness? Even if you have some definition for consciousness, like in any other phenomenon, if it is not so familiar, we need to place it. We cannot have somebody who is not so familiar but floating around. So you need to locate him or her. So where is consciousness? Can we pinpoint where exactly the locality of consciousness, the form of consciousness? So that's why we have a whole lot of discussion on different cortical areas responsible for different functions of what makes us a person. Now, when did it happen? So is there a particular time when this particular function of the brain or our personality emerges? So when did it exactly happen? There's also this question, why did it happen? Why should there be a consciousness at all? Why should there be something called consciousness at all? There is a question of evolutionary advantage of talking of when you talk about consciousness, a teleological approach to it. The last question is, who is talking about all this? Because the most interesting thing about consciousness is, when we talk about consciousness, the most interesting thing is that the person who talks about it is definitely a part of the inquiry, even if we try to be objective as much as possible, because at least at some moment we try to turn inward and ask questions about ourselves. So can mental and spiritual transformation and progress lead to neural progress? There are books like Jonathan Call where he describes where patients with severe brain malfunctions, with the help of their own positive attitude and willpower, are able to attain at least some level of neural and motor progress. To stop very abruptly there and to go to something which all of us may be interested in, is the Indian ways of knowing and experiencing. If you look at Indian tradition in large, the very word darshana means to see. It just means to see. So there is nothing so metaphysical when you talk about Indian philosophy, though there is a misinterpretation about Indian philosophy, that Indian philosophy talks about transcendence more and less about your day-to-day life. But the whole Indian philosophy, if you have one name, it just means to see what you see. And there are two paradigms. One is what is given and immanent, what is given for us. And the second is what is possible, transformative and transcendental. Discussions on consciousness and mind and self takes place in the context of these two paradigms. What is given to us and then what is possible for us. The purpose of religion and discussion on spiritual experiences or spiritual inquiry is to transform what we call as a ego consciousness or a limited self-identity to something larger. Of course, the usual description is universal consciousness. But what we understand it is something larger. How more can we expand our boundaries? And the whole idea of moksha, it lies in the context of this discussion. That's why there is this famous Upanishadic verse, Pariksha Lokan Karmachitan Brahmana Nirvedamayat. Most of you would know this, a famous verse, which says that this young boy who has experimented a lot with life finally became dispassionate and turned inward, desirous of immortality. And then it also says that these kind of people are really rare who would like to turn inward, because so much is there outside which fascinates. Next slide, please. And from there on, we have also a concept of adhikari, that it's not that everybody could try to venture into understanding or starting an inquiry into any subject. You need certain qualifications and certain aptitudes if you have to deal into that particular subject, and that's called as adhikari, a person-oriented method rather than an object-oriented method. And that's why many of the sutra texts, the Brahma Sutra, the Mimamsa Sutra is the main philosophical sutra text, it starts with adhado, thereafter, therefore. So something after you have done something and therefore you are starting into something. This particular inquiry. So in short, what we mean to say is the way of looking at a problem really matters. There of course seems to be a subjective involvement into what we think otherwise is an objective inquiry. Another very interesting feature of the Indian traditions in large is that there is a continuous attempt to relate the profane and the sacred. For example, in Taittiriya Upanishad, in the one of the last chapters, there is a comparison between Annam and Brahman. It says, "I am food. I am eater of the food also." So it's not that you have to always relate the truth which we are talking about only to a transcendental plane, but we can also be related to something which is very essential for our daily existence. The other example is about Purusharthas, the cardinal set of goals and guidelines, which talks about not only dharma and artha, but also kama and moksha. So how to optimize these four goals is a major attempt for Indian philosophical traditions. But the main feature which you see in all this is an urge for the beyond, to see something beyond. The major ideas in Indian philosophical traditions. So one is the jnana, or self-knowledge, which try to equate knowing yourself with knowing everything or becoming everything. Once you know that, you become everything. Or once you know the true nature of yourself, you see how much the boundaries between yourself and the rest of what you call as otherwise the other diminishes. The other is bhakti, love, and complete merge. How can you understand unconditional love? Because we don't have to talk about love, because all of us relate with that in our daily life. But is there something called unconditional love? Or how do you understand a merge of your own individual self in that? The third is natya, or the enactment and rasa, and I should not be talking about it with the presence of Dr. Mrinalini Sarabhai here, but this is again another important idea in our tradition about enactment, a detached engagement. Hinduism, in general, Indian philosophy as a repertoire of tools for dialogues between various kinds of experiences, but if you can reduce it to two or three. The first is well-being. What is primarily important is your own well-being. After all, do you feel good about what you're doing and how you're pursuing your thing, your inquiry? The second is immortality, which of course is not anymore ancient. You would know that there are books like Live Today to Live Forever, like people like, I forget his name, if somebody remembers that name, Live Today to Live Forever, who talks about taking 250 food supplements. And he says that with the combination of nanotechnology and biotechnology and brain studies, maybe you might extend your life to a few more decades. Who knows? So there is this idea of immortality. But then what exactly is the nature of immortality? Is it just extending the body identity you have? Or is it something which you think there's a deeper identity, which you call as a self? So what exactly is the nature of immortality? So in the whole process, the attempt is to define or redefine what we otherwise always gives importance to, self-identity. So as I just mentioned earlier, the discussion in Indian tradition is between two, engagement and detachment. And this comes primarily in a very good focus in Natyashastra, and also in a text like Gita, which talks about karma and sannyasa. How can you engage in something completely at the same time renouncing something which would otherwise detract you from doing what you wanted to do. The discussion of consciousness, when I say consciousness here, what I mean is the discussion on self, mind, your day-to-day experiences, and so on, is in the context of experience, transformation, and the inquiry into the nature of the other and me. This duality, again, is very important in many of the discussions in Indian traditions. For example, Shankaracharya talks about in his introduction to the Brahma Sutra, the importance of discussing with the two ideas of asmad and yushmad. Asmad, yushmad, pratyaya, gojareyo. There's a beautiful description on that. So primarily, most of these traditions are not interested, or at least not focused on explanation and event-centered, but more interested in experience, personal experiences, and possibilities. So we have two challenges if you take the greater, the larger context of consciousness and consciousness studies. One is the impersonal brain. Unless you look at the brain, you cannot move forward, at least in science. And that is what makes consciousness available. But then we also have personal experience based on which we try to relate consciousness and brain. And the personal experience is what makes consciousness evasive and elusive. And that's very interesting that consciousness can be at the same time available, it can also be elusive. It looks like we cannot have either one without the other. You cannot study the brain without your personal experiences. We can study the impersonal brain only in the context of personal experiences and our sense of self-identity. Now, if you look at consciousness, again in this scenario, it looks like consciousness is the door which perfectly opens towards equally existing spaces of a scientific exploration, if you can say it's an objective exploration, and spiritual experiences. The three top questions I wish to mention in this context, which the Science magazine published in its 125th anniversary issue, that science will be excited about in the coming 25 years is, what is the universe made of? What is the biological basis of consciousness? And why do we have so few genes? You can already find out, you already see how so many subjective factors have crept in the primary question. Shashi. Another important issue is about agency. When you talk about experience, especially when you read Vilayanu Ramachandran's book, The Phantoms in the Limb, and the other book also, The Emerging Mind, you would no more have a sacred sense of your self-identity. You see that yourself keeps on redefining, and how fragile it is when you look at odd, regular, and inexplicable experiences you can have, prone to slight changes in your brain. But at the same time, there is also increasing evidence that the reinforcement of positive attitudes and emotions can lead to some level of neural progress. Indian psychology and medicine are replete with such a method. It looks like consciousness studies will lead in the coming, at least say, let us say, a decade or two, revolutionary progress in brain studies and understanding anomalies. Not just only because of the advancements in brain studies and the different instruments we have now designed, but also now we have started giving more importance to the role of experience in understanding consciousness and even brain. So how can you, for example, augment and create spiritual well-being? Can you explore new meanings for self-identity? Well, we are left with three exciting E's for understanding consciousness. One is explanation. It looks like we keep on changing our explanations. We keep on reaching new explanations, depending upon the new challenges and the new shifts in paradigms. The other is exploration. You redefine the methods itself. You have an innate urge, apart from a strict scientific inquiry, to understand what is the nature of yourself. And finally, I think experience is the major factor in all this, because if not for experience, we will not be doing what we do, which we find is the most exciting thing. Thank you so much.
Can we say, is there any experience in scientific studies also? Just like we have experience in art or other forms, because so many people seem to be interested in science also.
Oh yeah, well, when I said experience, I didn't want to distinguish it just an art experience or so on. But I said, as the basic individual, as an individual, of course, your values, your ways of looking, your attitudes, your certain disciplines you might have would influence what you want to look at.
Yeah, I have a very basic question. It might seem simplistic, but at the end of this, it's on the second day of the conference, and we haven't yet addressed the question. You put that question, what is consciousness? And there are many perspectives. But I think a previous speaker also gave a particular definition of consciousness. But I would just like to know, what are the perspectives and what is consciousness? Can you answer that question? Maybe different views, what are the views? Because we're talking of consciousness here, but what are the different views of consciousness that are there in current thought?
Well, as I said, Mahesh, you have several working definitions for consciousness as far as your method is concerned. So you can have a definition within which is in the context of certain neural data, certain cortical areas, or certain expression of intelligence, which need not be involved with the brain at all, as you found in Professor Mahadevan's presentation. But then, I'm sure we will be bothered by the question, what is consciousness? Do we have one answer to that? But I think that would be a bit difficult because there are so many disciplines which are involved in understanding this complex phenomenon. And also, perhaps we are not looking at something very linear and so easy to comprehend, and we need a dynamic approach towards it. But as far as we are clear in what context we are trying to understand consciousness, we can imagine some level of progress in understanding it.
I just wanted to ask that you said you ended your talk with this explanation, experience, and
exploration.
In all this search of consciousness, what is the role of communication or language? In the sense of in exploring this, because I feel that the basic reason why we can ask this question is because we can communicate with each other. So, in the process of trying to, we experience it fine, but if we weren't able to communicate, would we have asked this question at all? So what is your take on the role of language or communication in all this?
The role of communication, definitely, I think that is why we are all here, and because it's not only we want to have a personal understanding of it, but we also want to have a consensus about what we think we have understood. Still, I would think that language basically would only try to communicate, but it may not represent entirely what we want to say is what we think is the truth or what we...
The reason I ask this question is because we all, if I take knowledge, I don't know what communication. I know what is consciousness. I know what I'm feeling about consciousness. So isn't it just about just putting it on into some kind of words that we are trying to do, maybe some symbols, mathematical symbols, or words in the...
Okay, are you asking that consciousness is only something which can be symbolically represented?
I'm not saying that. I'm saying, what is our search? Are we trying to do this? Are we trying to do this, or is it something more than this?
We
all understand it. I'm sure all of us know that we are conscious. All of us know who is I. So, you know that.
Yeah, I think what you're trying to say is that is there something more to understanding consciousness apart from what we represent it in our various disciplines? Is there something more?
Yeah, exactly.
Or is there something more than what you basically experience as I, which is the first definition of consciousness? Is that?
Does our search for it end if we can represent consciousness in the form of some words or in maybe some...
Yeah, well, the fascinating idea about not only consciousness, maybe many other issues which are complex, is that the search wouldn't end. And the joy lies in the process. So is there something more in understanding consciousness just than having a basic awareness of the I-ness and therefore knowing consciousness? Certainly. That lies in probably the creative processes. That's why consciousness is best understood in a dynamic context.
We can't differentiate between language and consciousness because what our thoughts are basically the languages. I mean, today if I'm not speaking, if I'm thinking, I either think in some languages, right? So I don't think we can differentiate between language and a consciousness.
I beg to differ with you, Ganesh.
Yeah.
Because in our lives, you know that you and me and many of us know that many things which we do and influence our life are not many often verbally represented.
No, just think for a moment. See, since after your birth, if there was no language in this world, there would have been no creation.
Yeah, well, this is a big debate of the chicken and egg, but let me not, which one is first and which one is final.
I have a basic question to ask, which is a little methodologically oriented. I'm just wondering that with the domination of the scientific paradigm, are we tending to be kind of rigidly paradigm bound, or let's say even deny or de-emphasize those things which we cannot explain using our existing theories, or and sticking to only one way of looking at things. I mean, as let's say Wilhelm Dilthey or even Friedrich von Hayek pointed out, are we, unknowingly being too very rigid in our approach?
I don't think so. I mean, what exactly do we mean by rigidity? Taking a few factors which you think would lead to some more clarity is not rigidity. It's just giving a structure. In any method, you see there is a structure. Perhaps some structures would have very limited, more quantitative, more tangible factors, but that does not mean that it is rigid. And also, I think it is, unless you have many different approaches, we won't be able to extend our imagination, and also the extent, the limit of our questions. So science definitely would not limit us. In fact, because of science, philosophers, psychologists, and many other people are able to get more clarity into what they're looking for.
Yes, but don't you think that other approaches are equally important in the sense, say, experiential?
Absolutely. But approaches. Nobody says that this is less important. Once we are sure that this is important, we can make a theory and we can present it. Nobody says it's less important.
And I was very interested. You spoke about the current dominant paradigm is that, the neural structures determine the psychological phenomena. But there are certain limited evidence that suggests that, let's say, cognitive behavior therapy, it has been shown to, change the kind of neurochemistry in, depression or OCD people. And there are also, experiments which suggest that if a person very strongly believes in something, there are so-called voodoo deaths. A person believes that a cast has been spelled on him, and just because he believes in it, his physiology just changes. So could you kindly comment on the other?
Yeah, I think that's a gray area. We also have stories about ayahuasca, how after having taken ayahuasca, this Amazonian drug, that you start seeing angels and so on. Well, this is a whole big world, but I think Narayanan wants to say something.
I don't think he has gone so far. Whenever we are speaking, physiological changes are the reactor. I don't think we need to find any exceptional phenomena. Every time we experience an event disorder, we are physiologically changing the structure of the neurons from a molecular level to a physiological level. Changes are occurring at various levels all the time. So I don't think we need to go.
I'm given to understand that you have a philosophical background, and from that background, would you say that consciousness does exist independent of the brain? And if it does exist, then we have to conclude the supremacy of the mind over the matter. And coming to the second part of it,
well, I already lost my mind on the first part.
If you want to speak on that, I will come to the second part of the question later. Otherwise, I will conclude now itself. The second part of the question is, does consciousness exist, or in your word, the being, does it continue to exist independent of the body? Because you touched that subject of our body and our continuation of the existence, and you also gave a very mundane view of how to live forever by living today, and you quoted a book. And does it really matter that our body's existence and its extension beyond a certain time is going to determine our consciousness? Or from a philosophical outlook, we ought to conclude that mind does not matter at all. I mean, matter does not matter at all, and we exist independent of the body.
Okay. You're losing me too.
Because I would feel that you would do real justice if you had concluded the Nachiketa story itself. Because Yama does give an answer to Nachiketa in the third part of the question. And you just left the question. Because yesterday when the death presentation was made, you immediately shot back saying that Hinduism doesn't talk about death as an end of your life. It says that you are only transcending it. It is only a way of it. But in your own presentation, I feel that you missed the point. Definitely, I feel you'll do justice if you conclude that. Thank you.
Well, I'm sorry that I don't know which point I missed. I was only talking about immortality, which is a major idea for inquiry in Indian traditions. And the whole idea of immortality is just not extending your body. In fact, I was trying to contrast Ray Kurzweil's book and the idea of immortality in Kadha Upanishad. So I think you lost me there in that. I was trying to take the other position. The immortality is just not relinquishing your body, but something more, a continuity of something which proceeds. And whether consciousness exists in spite of the brain, which is the first question, because I think in between I lost you. Consciousness exists in spite of your brain. I think even to answer that, I need my brain. Yes, independent of my brain. Well, at this moment, to be quite honest, I need my brain to answer that. So I don't know.
A very simple question. When you have an amoeba on a microscope slide, when it moves towards a lump of sugar or retreats from some acetic acid, would you say it has consciousness? And if so,
yes.
What kind of consciousness is it? It's a single-celled, immortal organism, quite in line with what she was thinking of.
Yes, Professor Radhakrishna, I know that way you are getting into. after listening to Professor Mahadevan's presentation and also learning a bit about amazing nature of bacterium, I tend to think that perhaps we should not give too much importance to brain alone to understand consciousness. Maybe the sheer fact of expressing intelligence as a way to survive should be taken as a mark of consciousness.
Live in a house called consciousness, and there seems to be only one and only house. At only one and only house, consciousness, and we know only the inner walls of it. Will it be possible for us to go out and see it? And will it be, I mean, can we go out or we stay always in the realm of consciousness? And whatever we do, like as you said, to see what is consciousness or to experience, we need brain. And
yeah, it's a very profound question, but I think in our life, we know that reflection, introspection, a few moments of quiet silence, and our need to relate to a sacred space, however we define that space, is so important to function in the regular daily life. So I think what you said certainly matters.
Thank you very much, Sangeetha.
Thank you. Yes, Professor Subhash Sharma, is very difficult to say no to him, and I know that we are already half an hour late, Subhash Sharma is the director of the Indian Institute of Plantation Management, and then you understand how I cannot say no to him. He wants to make a 5 minutes presentation on some ideas which he thinks he's fascinated about, so I think perhaps we should give that 5 minutes to him. And thereafter, we go to the posters and then for lunch. Professor Subhash Sharma.
And when you look at the reality,
exploration of that which explores the matter. Now, exploration of the matter is what the traditional scientific approach is all about, hypothesis testing and reasoning and this and that, the so-called Western science. And the second route to reality is the so-called Eastern science, which I call the Rishi route to reality, the Rishi approach to explore the reality around us. You can call it knowing and the being approaches. And both are required, as I think Sangeetha also mentioned, and that both are required with a view to improve the material and spiritual conditions of humanity. And I think in 21st century, we can feel the need for both of them. Last century was basically focused on the left side, and I think today we realize that both are required. This takes us to what I call the concept of the matrix of consciousness. Now, in the Indian tradition, these four levels of consciousness are very well defined, the waking and the dream and the deep sleep and the transcendence. What I have done is, I have added the another dimension to this matrix, and that is the perception dimension. One is the state of consciousness, and the second is the perception dimension. Is our perception ordinary perception, or is it what I call the ESP, not the ESP with which we are familiar? This ESP is the extended sensory perception, the extended sensory perception. For example, in nature we find that animals have much bigger extended sensory perception in certain dimensions than the human beings. But the human beings have the capability to extend their sensory perception through technology. We have the telescope, we have everything. So we have extended our eyes, we have extended our brain, we have extended our mind, and the concept of extended mind I was seeing in the poster presentation. And then the third state is the extraordinary perception, the EOP, which probably Professor Rao will define it as paranormal or some other phrase like that. So now we have what I call the matrix of consciousness, and this matrix of consciousness gives us the 12 different cells. Now our knowledge about consciousness, are we looking from the cell number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12? From which level we are looking at it? And depending upon the level from which we are looking at it, we will have different kinds of perspectives about the consciousness. And in this extreme point is what I call the etc. point, and that is the extended transcendental consciousness, the state of extended transcendental consciousness, which different people will probably define by different words. For example, the mystical experiences and those kinds of things will really fall into the cell number 12 or somewhere around that. And why I'm looking at this matrix is because my interest is twofold. One is from the viewpoint of the management, and second is from the viewpoint of the creativity. Now, the creative people, when we look at these levels of consciousness, from which state they tend to operate, you will find that they're very easily, they reach the cell number 12, the etc. state. And that's where we find the charismatic creativity, the concept of charismatic creativity, whether it was Mozart or in the music field or many dance field, many other fields, you will find that the people are able to reach from the waking state, from this state to that particular state. So that is the basic idea of the matrix of consciousness. Now this matrix takes us to what I call the three quantum states of mind, or the three ways of knowing. And one of the themes of this conference is the ways of knowing. And what are those three ways of knowing? The first one is, I call it as the division approach. You divide. That is the typical scientific approach. You divide the problem, try to study the sub-problem, and then you try to find the solution. Now that is the division approach, which really is divided vision. So you have the divided vision of the reality. The second one is, I call the division approach, which is like looking at the rainbow. You don't look at only the violet color or the red color. You look at the rainbow in its entirety. So that is the division. And the third one is the direct vision. That is the darshana, she mentioned, to see. Darshan, direct perception. If we combine these two words, direct and perception, we get this concept of darshan. In darshan, there is a direct perception of reality. And from that direct perception of reality, you create new knowledge. And probably that is the reason why Indian philosophy was known as darshana and not as division approach. And that's what I call from the thinkers to the Tirthankara. So that is the complete spectrum of reality. that you can look at the reality from a thinker angle, or if you become a Tirthankar, you look at reality from that viewpoint. Just a few seconds more. Well, there are a lot of applications of this, and this I have given it from the viewpoint of the management and the social sciences and the things which happen around us. The first approach leads us to conflict with nature, second, harmony with nature, and the third one, the symphony of nature. Example, conquest of Everest, not quest of Everest. If you go by the second approach, it was quest for Everest. And if you go by the third approach, it was merging with the Everest. Look at feminism. It was man versus women. It was again rooted into the division approach. The man-women complementarity, that is the division approach. And the direct vision approach is the yin-yang integration or the Shiva-Shakti concept. Democracy without responsibility. Division. Division, democracy with responsibility, and direct vision, democracy with responsibility and dignity. Clash of civilization, everybody is talking about it. Again, division approach has led to that. Division takes us towards dialogue of civilization, and direct vision takes us towards the confluence of civilization. Human being as a factor of production from economics, and human being as a co-creator, and human being as a divine being. The whole concept of management changes, whole concept of relationship changes, whole concept of... So what is the difference? In division, there is a subject-object distance. That is a typical scientific model. In division, there is a subject-object nearness. And in direct vision, there is a subject-object fusion. Dancer becomes the dance. We have the example here. So that is the, that is the third approach. So first one is the analytical mind, second is the intuitive mind, and the third one is the integrative mind. The first one is the scientific approach, the experimental approach, the three E's of a different type here. The second one is the artist, which is the experiential, and the third one is encounter, and that is the Rishi approach. So these are the three different approaches to look at the reality and solve the problems around us. And that leads us to next framework. It is an extension of the same, a kind of a typology of the thinkers, or the typology of the scientists, or the typology of the researcher. That from which viewpoint we are looking at it, are we looking at it from the mono angle or the poly angle? Are we looking at it from the advaitic view or the dvaitic view? That means the division or the direct vision. Then this gives us four types of scientists, four types of thinkers, and also four types of religions. Different religions can be analyzed from this perspective. So you have the mono approach and the advaitic approach, the Shankara and the Schrodinger. Yesterday it was mentioned about it. The micro-macro unity is achieved through that. And then you have the different approaches. If you want to go into detail, you can discuss with me later on. And final question of the consciousness is, who am I? And I think I have these four levels of consciousness. I have deliberately put it in Hindi just to create a rhythm. Main hoon kaun? Who am I? A scientist will say, I am Chon, C-H-O-N, carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen. That is the scientist definition of Main hoon kaun. And then somebody else will say, I am an icon, the inner consciousness. I am nothing but the inner consciousness. So that is the inner definition. And then somebody will say, I am cosmic consciousness. I am the universal spiritual consciousness. That is at the cosmic level. That is the Shubham Shubham level. So it depends from which level we are really talking or trying to answer. Whether from the division angle, then we get one answer, or the division angle, we get another answer, or the direct vision angle, we get the another answer. Thank you very much. Are available, I will leave a copy outside.
Thank you, Subhash.
Thank you very much.
You're always well known for the nice acronyms you make. We have two poster presenters who are waiting impatiently, and I seek their apologies to them to invade about 35 minutes from their time. They are V. Harinarayanan from IIT Kanpur, who will present on consciousness, self, and metaphor. And Dilip Atreya from Center for Behavior and Cognitive Sciences, Allahabad, who will present on epistemic action, a link to consciousness in extended mind. So my suggestion would be, let us spend a few minutes, not few minutes, until one with them, and then proceed for lunch. And let us come back at least 5 minutes before two and be seated here to listen to a very important lecture this afternoon by Dr. Manalini Sarabhai. So please make sure that you are seated in this hall by 1:55. Thank you.
After flipping it and turning it to the left, what will happen?